When I take his name, I feel inspired. As a lawyer, as a citizen of India, and as a humanity, Mr. Sital Bhatt is the institution in his himself. Mr. Sital Bhatt will be remembered. Mr. Sital Bhatt will be remaining so long the constitutional democracy will be remaining in our country. And I am envious of Mr. Pillai, who is the torchbearer of this legacy, and still he here to tell us what he was. And today is the day this great man took his birth. And I feel fortunate to be here and to remember him, this great man. I remember when I have completed his practice of 10 years only, one senior advocate who had the privilege to appear with Mr. Sital Bhatt in Supreme Court in Calcutta Bar. At that time, he was aged about 89 years old. And when I left the courtroom while arguing a matter against Mr. Somna Chatterjee, who is the son of the greatest, one of the greatest son of A.N.C. Chatterjee, and Mr. Somna Chatterjee lost to me, then I came out. And this gentleman just called me to his bar association chair. And then I had gone there. He had a book with him. And this book was purchased by him in the year 1968, perhaps. And it was purchased by him. He read it. And this purchased book, old book, he handed over to me as a treasure gift. I am preserving that book. And what he has read, underlined in his own way, I have read in my own, I have underlined the book, old book is still in my library in Calcutta. 28th of January 1950 was a very illustrious day, one of the day, when Supreme Court of India started functioning. The then Chief Justice of India, Kanhaiya, spoke on behalf of the bench what should be the power of the Supreme Court under Article 32 of the Constitution of India and vis-a-vis the rule of law. He spoke, if I remember from quotation of Mr. Sital Bhatt's book, My Life. Rule of law was established partly, I don't say fully, when Government of India Act 1858 came into force. Before that, there was no defined right and obligation of anyone else. And this is the foundation. As you know, the rule, this Government of India Act 1858 was enacted for taking over the power from the East India Company of the Hindustan by the Parliament itself. So Parliament started ruling, British Parliament, followed by establishment of three high courts. In the criminal law field, there was no defined offense. Whatever the people used to, Kaji used to think this is an offense, this is an offense. So Kaji, being a judge making the law, and is adjudicating then and there. This was the criminal justice delivery system. Civil justice delivery system was, of course, with the Britishers to protect the revenue, namely East India Company. But then Indian Penal Code came 1860. Shortly thereafter, defining offense, what is offense? Mind that at that time, bigamy was incorporated in offense. It was there, what is murder, what is theft, and everything. So rule of law is established. Why I say rule of law? Rule of law is required to see our judicial activism, because unless there is a law, what is the activism on what? The rule of law was there from that way onwards. Income Tax Act came into force 1866, then tax liability, what is the corporate sector, and etc. Before that, all arbitrary decision by this. Immediately after the Constitution came into being, the power of the Supreme Court was tested. Famous case of Bihar Land Reforms Bill, and the bill was struck down. And the act was struck down, sorry to say, act was struck down by majority of judgment. Dr. Bijoy Mukherjee was the author of the judgment, if I remember correctly. And the constitution had to be amended thereafter. Then, after that B.G. Rose case, you are well known, they're defining the power of the constitution, amending power and etc. Then comes I.G. Gurunath versus State of Punjab. I.G. Gurunath versus State of Punjab says that, as you know, the fundamental right portion cannot be amended. But illustrious and famous case, 13 bench decision, a full bench of Supreme Court, Kesavananda Bharati versus State of Bihar came. And in this judgment, in this judgment, for the first time, the Supreme Court just laid down the concept of basic structure theory. And in this judgment, it was said, any portion of the Constitution can be amended by the amending power under Article 368 of the Constitution of India by the Parliament. And this right is taken away by the Constitution, setting up the tribunal, so to say. Tribunal can stick. But when L. Chandrakumar's case, it was decided that tribunal can function playing a supplemental role, not the supplanting role of the High Court in the matter of Article 226-227. But thing is this, Parliament has been given a power to constitute the tribunal to limit in an indirect way and carve indirect way the power of the High Court, so to say, under Article 226-227. Because L. Chandrakumar's judgment had explained that no litigant without approaching the tribunal first formed under Article 323A and B cannot straightway come to the High Court. One has to go through the tribunal. Whereas the Constitution provides any citizen of India can approach to the High Court under Article 226. But the Supreme Court has pronounced this. But I must mention, there is a gray area. There is no challenge as on today whether Article 323A and B of insertion of this article in the Constitution book itself is unconstitutional or not. That is never decided by any court. Because as I understand, but I will request no one will take the advantage of my speech today in court. And don't quote it, your lordship has spoken. It is my absolutely personal. As our great man, Mr. Pillai, has said the contempt of court, only to answer, I say, contempt of court, you know very well and better than mine. Contempt of court is meant for the upholding of majesty of justice, not upholding the ego or prestige for the individual judge or to glorification of a personality of a judge. It is the institution and justice delivery system. That is the concept of contempt. So whatever is spoken in relation to a person as a judge is not a contempt according to my understanding. And therefore, nothing to do with the contempt. And moreover, it is well settled that if truth is spoken, and if there is a justification of any things in relation to anything else, fair criticism, outside purview of the contempt. So it is always there. But that doesn't mean we shall abuse this right. Because if you abuse any judge, we are not abusing a judge in person. You are abusing an institution. Is abusing a chair. This chair is meant for the public and not for any individual, not even for the judge individual himself. As you know, a judge can be liable for committing contempt of his own court. It's possible. So naturally, coming to this concept of judicial activism, now what we are doing nowadays, executive sometimes for some reason cannot do their job or do their duty. It is settled position of the law. Mandamus can be issued in the case of where there's a statutory duty to be performed by the statutory authority and executive also. And also, the power coupled with duty, mandamus can be issued. What is happening nowadays, if the executive does not do anything else, where is the citizen will go? Obviously, the citizen will come to court, and this duty has not been discharged, and obligation has not been discharged by the executive or legislative or any state having instrumentality of the state. And obviously, it's not the power of the court, nay, duty. That is what Mr. Sitalwar says. Nay, it is a duty of the superior court to compel the executive to discharge your duty. Because you owe a duty to the citizen of India, you are bound to do. And this is the role that is being played by the judiciary successfully with admiration. But unfortunately, somewhere and some corner, it is constituted to be an overactivism and exceeding the Lakshman Rekha. But not a single case I have found. In present situation, the judiciary has exceeded in Lakshman Rekha. And judiciary has taken you. Now I'm mentioning about the appointment of the Supreme Court and High Court judges. This is a collegium concept has been introduced by 9-bench decision in 1991. There again, Justice Samedi and Justice Punchi express their different view. See, in-house checking and balance. But it was required to be done, as it has been mentioned in the judgment, because the appointment of the judges is one of the preconditions for maintaining the element of independence of judges. So if the appointment procedure is left with the hand of the executive exclusively, then executive representative is going to the court and to see the interest of the executive. Executive interest includes the political executive, not the executive government alone. And political executive means in the political personality. I believe if you read this judgment, it will appear to save the situation it was done. But you will agree with me that no system in the democracy can be made with foolproof, 100% foolproof. There must be somewhere some lacuna. Taking advantage of the lacuna, some people are saying something else. But of course, every person has got his own liberty to say, express their view. Freedom of expression is ensured. We welcome is a vibrant democracy. So we are doing that. In case of, I tell you one case, in sexual harassment to the working place. We are a signatory to the Beijing Conference in 1995. And we promised that we shall make a suitable law regarding the sexual, to prevent the sexual harassment of the women in the working place. We couldn't do. But Supreme Court, in the Visakha's case, Visakha versus State of Rajasthan, how the judicial activism has gone into that. As I say, there's a role of the to make the law also. It is done. Sexual harassment was found. So the Supreme Court laid down till the legislation is made, but you have not made any legislation. Till the legislation is made, the direction given by the Supreme Court to be treated as a law. And no doubt, naturally, Article 141 is their law. Whatever declared by the Supreme Court is the law of the land. And it was operating till 2013 in the month of January, when 2013 the Parliament and the legislature thought it fit and woke from the slumber to make the legislation which was contemplated in 1995, Beijing Conference. In other countries it was done, it was not done. Had there been no judicial intervention and judicial activism, perhaps I don't know whether this sort of enactment should have been there or not. Supreme Court, time and again, and High Court also failed that regarding these sexual offenses against the women. This has to be, more stringent provision has to be made. And recently you know that Parliament was bound to do because of judicial observation. It was done. Parliament has amended recently Indian Penal Code, you know that, in which is called Nirbhaya Act. So it is done. So these are the, I am giving few examples like this. And what is the judicial activism in the interpretation of statute also, which was not possible? You know, before me, there is a challenge. What happened, you know the kesa somisas, concept of kesa somisa in the interpretation of statute. In this field, the power of judiciary is there to make the law in a extraordinary circumstances. What the legislature has not spoken, applying the concept of kesa somisa, the judiciary can, in the judicial activism, can do it. What happened in Calcutta in 2010, Section 260, capital A of the Income Tax Act came before me. And there is no power of condonation of delay or preferring appeal. I must say, hundreds and thousands of the litigation on behalf of the revenue were destroyed because in absence of the power. And after a period of limitation on 120 days, it had to be dismissed as a matter of course. Some very influential people, the assessee, could manage the department so that the appeal could not be filed by the department within the period of 120 days. Lakhs of crores of revenue have gone down. Then even one judgment or division bench shared in another high court that no, there is no power of condonation of delay. In 260 capital A, it is static 120 days. Case came before me. Then I made some judicial activism or judicial adventurism, I do not know. But one has to make a distinction between judicial activism and judicial adventurism. In the name of judicial activism, there should not be judicial adventurism. Then I did. I then said, Section 260 capital A adopts the procedure of the Civil Procedure Code as provided under Order 41 of the Code of Civil Procedure.